Israel, you will not notice it. Who here had the privilege to visit Israel? Raise your hands. One. So I can say two. So I can say almost whatever I want about Israel, and you want. Okay, no problem. So 70% desert. The land is surrounded by countries, and we will talk about it. Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, and Egypt, and from the other side we have the Mediterranean. So when my parents were young, they stood in the line with coupons of for milk powder and egg powder in the 50s, and let's say 60 years later, in 2010, we have joined the OECD with an excellent economic data. For example, our GDP now is $350.9 billion, which is wow. In a minute you'll understand why. The GDP per capita, also you can see a huge rise. Also, when we had there was a global crisis, and still in Israel the GDP per capita was very high, and today is around $39,000 per capita. Do you know how much is it in Ghana? It's 4,500. So the majority of the domestic product is in Israel are services, and then industry, and on parallel the rate of the unemployment is dropping, and today is, let's say, 5%. Israel is an excellent destination for foreign direct investments, FDIs, and actually 4.5% of our GDP is an FDI. Like other countries, multinational companies are investing in Israel, and we will understand why. And the inflation is lower than ever. I'd like to say that in the 80s we had inflation of hundreds of percents, hundreds, and we have to make the new Israeli shekel, the new currency, and to drop off a lot of zeros in order to there was a transformation, and I have a lot of other very nice numbers to show it, but I think that the real question is how. And today we are going to take three case studies, and we are going to test each and every one of them and deduce how Israel made it, how we made it from a developing country to a developed country. The first sector is agriculture. Okay, we're going to talk about agriculture, the diaspora, which is very relevant to Ghana, and innovation. This is actually the wow effect. This is what made Israel what it is currently. So about agriculture, Israel became a huge, well, one of the leading countries in the world on agriculture. Even our cow is the most productive cow in the world. Okay? Although only 1% of the GDP in Israel is coming out of agriculture, Israel was an agrarian society. And with time, it became agrotechnology society. But to understand how did it happen, we have to look at the history and the context of what happened in Israel. So when the people, the Jewish people, returned to their homeland after 2,000 years in exile, they found a desert. Nothing was there. Nothing. There were a lot of waves of immigration coming to Israel, a lot of Jews who ran away from Europe and some from Africa and from the US. They wanted to make a new country, to have their own homeland for the Jewish people, but they didn't have any way to produce food or water in the desert. They also could not import or export, export of course not, but could not import anything because, as I said, the borders are with hostile countries. So actually, Israel was a political island. And when these people came, they understood that they have to do something. They have to find a solution themselves. There was a necessity and there was a need and they have to solve it. So, how will they solve this issue of water and agriculture without any experience? Because if they came from Europe, they were not farmers in Europe. No. They were merchants. The women stayed at home. Maybe they were studying in the university, but they didn't have a lot of experience in agriculture. And they decided that they are going to invent the new Jew. And the new Jew is a farmer, a warrior, and a secular person. Okay, we'll get to it. But these people, they didn't want to have anything with their history, with their religion or tradition. And the fact that they didn't have tradition actually helped them to innovate later because they were not, they didn't have to obey to their tradition. They could have done whatever they wanted. So, and there were other things that worked for their best. First of all, the historical inheritance. We are talking about the British mandate in Israel. The British mandate was very bad, of course, but they also built trains and roads in Israel. They had a legacy of democracy, and they made a lot of things that stayed actually until today and helped Israel became what it is. Another thing is the human capital. The people, the Jewish people who came to Israel were very academic wise. They had a lot of experience, and there were a lot of researchers or physicians and nurses, and they wanted to, they had a lot of knowledge. Another thing that helped them is the social welfare policy. Sorry. The country began in the socialist era, okay? The USSR was the best thing in the world. This is what everybody thought. So there was a lot of emphasis on giving the people of Israel the basic needs. Today in Israel, like then, there is a healthcare insurance to every citizen. It's by law. Children has to study. It's a law. Has to study for free from 3 years old until 18 years old, and they must complete 12 years in school. And this gave a very, very good base to the developments later. So in a research or study that several organizations made, the Tony Blair Institute, AGRA, which you know, and the Volcani Institute in 2019, actually they made this research especially for Ghana. They are asking themselves, what are the six or what are the key factors that enabled Israel to succeed in agriculture? And this is the answer. First of all, they are saying there was strong leadership and governmental commitment to agriculture. Secondly, effective government, innovation, farmer organizations, market-led approach, and support from abroad. I will not go through everything, but I will focus on several things that I think may have to do with Ghana. First of all, the government. This is our first prime minister, David Ben-Gurion. He himself was a farmer, so he had a deep commitment to farming. And he himself lived in the peripheral area of Israel. So also he had a deep commitment to the peripheral areas. And with his vision and his commitment, he paved a pipeline from the Sea of Galilee, which was the only water source in Israel, until the Negev, the southern part of Israel, to the desert, and actually made agriculture possible over there. So he had a personal commitment, and also his people in the government, most of them were farmers. Do you remember the new Jew? He is a farmer. This is the vision. So most of them were farmers and they wanted to invest in it. Another thing that helped is policy continuity, which means his party, the Labor Party, ruled Israel for 30 years. It's a lot, yeah, maybe too much, but it helped them to provide a continuous policy and to invest in the same things and not, you know, after 4 years go and sit in the opposition and then the whole policy is changing. A lot of luck were in this story. And of course, they gave budget. And budgeting is important in anything that the government decides to do. In Israel, they have to put budget. I'm pretty sure it's everywhere. But there is no success without budget. Another thing that helped the agriculture become what it is today in Israel is the establishment of key government structures. For example, the Crop Production and Marketing Boards. Do you know the Cocoa Board? You know the Cocoa Board. This is a creation of the British, right? They created it even before Ghana got its independence. They did the same everywhere, also in Israel. But in Israel, they created the Citrus Board. We had a lot of oranges in Israel. So the Citrus Board, which was a creation of the British mandate, its position, or it included both the Minister of Agriculture, but also the growers themselves, the farmers. And together they could have sat and decide on solutions or ask questions or get the help of the minister. Another thing that helped agriculture, and actually it's a main thing, is research. And I know that this university is doing research, and it's very, very important. Agriculture research of the Volcani Institute This institute is was established in order to make research and development only on agric, only. And today they have, if I'm not mistaken, I've written it here. Yeah, 200 scientists. If can someone help me to see the, yeah, thanks. So they have 200 scientists sitting and researching and developing on agriculture. Wonderful, thank you. For example, Israel is not a tropical country, right? But the most fruit that we import the most is avocado. Although avocado cannot grow in the desert at all. Okay, this is the place for avocado. Or mango. We export tons of mango abroad. How come? In the 70s, I don't know who, a farmer, wanted to grow mango, and he brought it to Israel. And they told him, how come mango? They need a lot of rain, they need a certain weather. What are you going to do with mango? And he sat with the Volcani Research Institute for Agriculture, and together they found a way to have a different kind of mango that will be able to survive the desert. And in order to see that this mango survives, they send it in a ship, the fruit, to Europe, to the markets in Europe, and went there to wait for it and to see that it's really, you know, holding up and the shelf life are fine. And this is the way that they solved the issue of mango. And they are, or for example, there was a problem with the, can't remember, a herb, a sort of a herb. There were always diseases for the herbs, and the crop, the yield, wasn't good. They were surveying, so the researchers were surveying again for days and nights, the greenhouse to see what's going on, what kind of germ is going inside and eating the crop. And they found out that the workers, like the farmers, are bringing it with their shoes. Okay? So they found out, they solved this problem, they wiped their shoes in a wet mat. And that's it. It's a lot of investment in order to solve something, but then the whole country can really export this product. And another thing is the extension services. I know that in Ghana there are also extension services, but in Israel, at the beginning, since it was so important for Israel to invest in agriculture, they had one extension worker for every 50 to 80 farmers. Now, these extension workers were friends or even brothers or neighbors of the farmers. So when someone had a problem, he came to his neighbor, who was an extension worker, and asked him, hi, can you help me with the bell peppers? I need your advice. Or can you help me with the eggplants? I need your advice. And together they were working on a solution. So today in Israel, because we reduced the amount of agric that we do, we have one extension worker for every 110 farmers. In Africa, if you'd like to know, generally in Africa, there is one extension worker for every 3,000 farmers. And I can tell you that it works because my father is a farmer and my mother is an extension worker. So at the end of the day, there was a golden triangle, okay? The innovative golden triangle of Israel. Volcani Institute, which is the Research and Development Institute, and then the 8 regional R&D centers, the extensions, and the farmer in the middle who is getting the answers from all around and can ask questions all around, and it works until now. This is agriculture. I can make a quick stop for questions, or we can move on to talk about the diaspora. Any questions? I'll finish it all. This is what I've been told, and I'm a good student. So let's talk about diaspora. Why is it relevant at all? We're talking about diaspora is the Jewish people who did not live or came back to Israel and stayed in Europe, in Africa, in the United States, or in Asia. Why is it important? They had a huge role in supporting Israel in its early times, but they have this role until today. But first, let's see a little bit of numbers, okay? As you see, Israel was not the center of the Jewish world until lately, okay? So if in the beginning of the 20th century, Israel had only 35,000, around 35,000 Jews in it, okay? And the majority of the Jews were scattered abroad. Today, we have the majority. The majority of the Jews in the world or the main center for Jews in the world is in Israel. Until lately, it was the United States. The United States had the maximum number of Jews in the world. As you can see, in 1942, between 1942 and 1970, suddenly you see a drop, a huge drop in the numbers, right? How come? The World War II, 6 million Jews were murdered by the Nazis. Until now, we haven't been able to came to the number that we were supposed to be. So if in the 1942 we had like 16 million Jews in the world, today overall total Jews in the world is 15 million. Okay, but So in order to make the diaspora part of the state of Israel, the Israeli government has its own policy, and we are doing a lot because we think that a strong Jewish community equals a strategic asset. They are an asset because they are working for us, they have their own lobbies, but we are also supporting them and giving them aid and supporting them in combating anti-Semitism in Europe and around. Or if there is a society somewhere in, I don't know, South America, that needs our help because of poverty or a volcano that erupts, we are there to help them. Hopefully, within the years, we will see more Jewish in Israel. But, you know, There are also Jews that prefer to live abroad. They don't want to be Israelis, and it's fine. To be an Israeli, it means that you'll have this R, terrible. Why? So they prefer to live abroad, and they are Americans or French or Italians or Moroccans or I don't know what, Chinese. And that's it. They are not Israelis. But they are working, they have a commitment to Israel, sometimes because of ideology, sometimes because they have relatives in Israel, part of their family immigrated to Israel, and sometimes because they have guilt feelings. Ladies and gentlemen, it's the same with the Ghanaian diaspora, and we are using it, and you can use it too. I'm not joking. That's fine. So we have several main Jewish world organizations that are operating outside, and sometimes instead of helping us, they are in opposition because they are not Israelis, they are Americans. So they have a lobby, but the lobby works two ways. They can help Israeli policy in Washington, but they can also tell us what to do. And they are a lobby group, not more than this. Actually, we owe them the State of Israel to these organizations. Two organizations that are located in Israel and are very, very old, and even before the State of Israel was established, are the Jewish National Fund and the Jewish Agency. What you see over there is a blue box. This box was in everybody's living room all abroad, all around the country, the countries, all around the globe. If you are Jewish, you had this little blue box. And in this blue box, children and parents were putting dimes or cents or something they were saving in order to contribute to the State of Israel. And the representative from the JNF was going around and taking the money, collecting the money. And in this money, within the years, the JNF was collecting, buying, purchasing lands in Israel and made agricultural development. And until today, it is the owner of 13.13% of the lands of Israel. It has planted until now 240 million trees in Israel. Remember, it's a small country, so it's enough trees. And built 180 dams. Okay? Can I have water? This is it. Okay, a small break while I'm drinking water. Thank you, sorry. Talking about the desert makes me thirsty. So, the Jewish Agency is actually an NGO, this second one. It's actually an NGO with a special status in Israel. And this NGO's goal is to bring as many Jews as they can to Israel, to make them immigrate. And in order to do so, why? First of all, because Israel is the homeland of the Jewish people. And secondly, because they are sitting well, as we say. They have deep pockets, and they can come and help us. And so what they do is trying to connect between the diaspora and Israel, to have this connection real. And they have several programs that I think that Ghana can do also that will work beautifully. For example, one of the programs is called Taglit Birthright. Hundreds or even thousands a year of young people from all around the world, Jewish of course, are coming and touring for 2 weeks, 3 weeks around Israel. This is what they do. They are just touring around. They are paying for it and some is subsidized, but it's a just grand tour in Israel for 3 weeks. They go back to their mothers and fathers and they say, I found out what makes me Jew. They see Jerusalem, they see the Wailing Wall, they see their homeland, and they understand what is the real connection between them and the state of Israel. And then, after their studies, they can come and do an internship in Israel in one of the programs of the Jewish Agency. Or they can volunteer in one of the programs that they have globally. And by the way, in Winneba, there is a group of Israeli and Jews, young people who are volunteering for the last 3 years they are there and working on education with the University of Winneba and with the community. And this is funded by the Jewish Agency as part of our effort to connect between the Jews in the diaspora and the Jews in Israel. So this is one of the uses that we've did. So just to make sure that I made my point, the connection between the diaspora and the state is very, very strong. Until today, when there is a new ambulance in Israel, it has a title donated by this and this for the sake of the memory of his wife or his father and so on. We are working with it and it's fine. It's fine because, believe it or not, people would like to contribute to their homeland. And I think that Ghana realizes that in the during the years. So the third thing that I wanted to discuss is innovation. Israel is a world leader in innovation. As you can see, the Global Competitiveness Index puts Israel the third in the world on innovation. And if we discuss agriculture, then today we don't have already a traditional agriculture in Israel. What we have is high-tech agriculture, agri-tech. These, for example, are in Volcani again, the research institute. These, they are receiving through a satellite the image of the field, and they know exactly which plant, okay? Not by meter, by plant, which one needs more irrigation or more fertigation, and according to it. I can tell you that when I was young, I was going with my father and we were picking eggplants by hand, okay? And in the season, we had to eat eggplants until we died, you know, but because this is what we had. But today, when my father is coming to visit me here in Ghana, and he came already twice, he is sitting on my computer, getting linked into his irrigation and fertigation system, and he can do everything from Ghana. And it's true. So of course at the end you'll have to pick the peppers or take it, but you have such a control, and this is only innovation. Only innovation, nothing else. So the pillars of Israel's innovation policy, first of all, is one innovation agency. We have the Innovation Authority in Israel. They get to decide what will be the next thing in Israel. For example, now we are investing a lot on health. Health and what we call medtech is one of the things that are receiving a lot of budget from the Israeli government, because we want to lead in innovation on medical and health issues. We are doing a lot of experiments and a lot of adaptations. A lot of the Israeli big innovation things are not really, were not really innovated in Israel. They took something from Russia, okay, and they improved it. So it's innovation because it's new and it answers a need, okay? But it wasn't theirs from the beginning. Everybody can do it. Just think outside of the box. And a lot of things that a very important thing is the PPP as strategy. Working together with the industry, working together with the business sector and the private sector. So in this process of innovation policy, there is an emphasis on collaboration. There are at least three elements. One is the academia and research institutes. Without the academia, there is nothing. Nothing. First, this is the base, okay? And then the Israeli industry is coming. They can take something that is already made, or they can ask something. Okay, they are going to the engineering or to the health sciences and saying, look, it costs quite a lot to do this, how do you call it when you pull a pipe to see gastroscopy. It costs quite a lot. How can we solve it? And it takes a while, and it's not comfortable, and the people just feel not nice when they have it. How can we solve it? So, people were thinking and thinking in Israel, and they invented the PillCam. And the PillCam is actually a tiny camera in a pill. You swallow it. It goes through your whole system, and the doctor can see it, okay? And you don't have to invade into your system and all. That's it. You are just swallowing. By the way, it was invented at least 15 years ago. It's not that new. Today there are things that I probably don't know about. But and another factor is the foreign players. A lot of foreigner or foreign companies would like to be part of it, part of the innovation, part of the science that is going on in Israel. And these two last players, the industry and the foreign players, are also giving the funds for the research in the academia. So today, over 300 multinational R&D centers are in Israel, all the best. They want to use the Israeli brain, and then they know why. The Motorola, you know, like an old name, yes. The Motorola R&D Center in Israel invented the technology of a cell phone. So what we use every day was invented in Israel, or the disk on key, how do you call it, the thing that you attach to the computer, also an Israeli innovation. So in all of this, there is a role of the government, okay? The government, first of all, is in charge for the infrastructure. You cannot promote innovation without giving them a good internet, cyber security, rooms to be developed, okay? You cannot do it, and this is the role of the government. Another thing is risk sharing. In Israel, the government shares the risks of the startups. For example, if you are a startupist and you have a wonderful idea, okay? The government can give you up to 50% of the money that you need for the first 2 years, and if you succeed, you will pay the government back. But if you fail, you don't have to pay. And this is something that the government can do. But as a government, you have to choose well. You cannot, you know, come and say, yes, everyone is welcome to think how is going to be the next, to do the next exit. But it takes a while. It's a lot of investment. You have to study well. Another thing that the government is doing is the government is in charge for social goals. There are things that the industry is not interested in. For example, poverty or food security. No, the industry would like to make money. So the government has to take this role and to invest in startups that will solve poverty or bring food security. It's difficult, of course. Whoever is going to do it will be very, very rich. But this is the goal of the government. And then in order to do these things, we have to invest a lot of money. So do you remember how much was the GDP of Israel? Who has a very good memory? It was around $350 billion. 4% of it is going for for R&D. 4%. Do you know how much Ghana invests in R&D? $0.01. So if you spend a lot of money, really, at the end of the day, this is the result. If in 2006, only 3 of the world's largest companies in the world had an R&D center in Israel. In 2016, 4 years ago, 8 out of the world's largest companies in the world have an R&D center in Israel. This is a real attraction. Talking about innovation, I just wanted to share with you a very nice thing. I don't know if you heard about it, but because of the desertification and because of the climate changes, we have much more people who don't have water to drink. And they are not next to a sea, so they cannot desalinate like we do, by the way. We don't have any more water scarcity because we desalinate maybe 70% of our water. So this is a special machine that was invented by young guys in Israel that takes the air and makes it water. So you can see here that people, it's in Africa somewhere, I don't know which country, maybe Uganda, they are standing and they are just, they're like filling like gas station, they are filling water and take it home, and that's it. The water are clean, everything is fine. Of course, this is, you know, it's like magic. I have some things to say. I'm going to skip this part. Sorry. And jump to the conclusion. So, we were talking about the things that Israel, the three cases or case studies that Israel did and that allowed Israel to become what we are today, a very strong country economically. I'm not saying that Israel is perfect. Israel has problems and challenges all around. But since only two people in the room were in Israel, I'm talking only about the good things. But if we would like to take the things that Israel did and adapt them, because we can never do exactly the same. Every country is different. The challenges are different. I would say that there are six things that we should look on. One is a strong welfare state foundations. First, every citizen has to have free water, clean water, free education, and free healthcare. This is the basic that we had in Israel. Then, establish an innovation system focused on problem solving. Identify the problem, solve it. Don't sit and say, oh, how many problems we have in life. No, identify, solve. Then, a market-led and value-led development approach. It means that you have, when you develop the solution, you have to think of the market, because at the end of the day, you want to sell. You want to have to make money from it. Another thing is organized pressure groups. And this is the role of you, of the citizens. Citizens can press the government. Citizens can be in union. They can make their own statements. This is happening a lot in Israel, especially in the unions. And a crucial role of the government. When the government says that they want to invest or to be the first in the world in health, they have to put money, a lot of money. And the last thing, use the diaspora. For us, it made a huge change. And since we are in the university, I wanted to make it short for us, so I came up with WMI God. These are the, okay, you'll see, welfare, innovation, market, organized group, government, and diaspora. These are the initials. Ladies and gentlemen, we are working with Ghana to share our knowledge and to share our story, but also really doing work. And I'm very happy to be here in Ho, and more happy to talk here in the university, because I think that you are the future and we are our friends, and I hope to see us all and keeping our friendship forever. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Your Excellency. We'll take a few questions. So there are a couple of microphones. If I catch your eye, then I will going to be sent to you. And then, yeah, okay, Professor Binka. So we'll take a few questions and then we'll, yeah.
Yeah. So thank you very much for the great talk. I lived in Jerusalem, in Kiryat Yovel, and I schooled in Hadassah. Yeah. So my question is, in the beginning, in those days, one of the interesting things about Israel was the kibbutz system. But you didn't seem to mention it at all. Was it a failure? Or how did this transform your agricultural setting to be agri-tech?
The next hand. Okay, Professor Fori.
Thank you for your insightful presentation. I like the blue box where they put money and people collect them and bring it. But that blue box brings my mind to corruption. Because I wonder what will happen here if Rafi agency collecting money all over and bringing it. So is there corruption, issue of corruption in Israel? How is it being dealt?
Okay, Piles.
Obviously, we've all come to agree that Israel has taken the lead. How is Israel pulling the third world along? Because there is a say that if you want to go fast, you go alone. But if you want to go far, you go with a team. What team are you forming with the developing countries? Thank you.
Okay, I'll take the fourth one, which will be the last for now. And then we'll...
My name is Kwame Hilary Kobe, and my question is about the New Jew, how it was completed in the country, because majority of the country would have might have opposed it. So how was the New Jew generalized in the whole country?
Okay, so thank you for these questions. First of all, the kibbutz, and I'm going to connect it together with this New Jew, okay? So as we saw in Israel, there were some Jews. For example, I'm the seventh generation in Jerusalem, which means that my great-great-great-grandfather came to Israel in 1880, something like this, or 1860. And they were Jewish Orthodox from the old school. The new movement of Jews, which believed in Zionism, which means that the state of Israel is the homeland for the Jewish people, came and they wanted to change, and they became the majority within time. So there wasn't any a problem with it then. Today it's totally different. We have ultra-Orthodox Jews, we have only Orthodox Jews, we have merchants, we have service providers. This is a concept that people had in Israel in the 20s, 30s, 40s, something like this. Today it's different. But one of the things that happened back then, since socialism was so strong in the world, and a lot of the immigrants, the Jewish immigrants who came to Israel, came from the Soviet Union, they established the kibbutzim. Kibbutz is a small communal village. Everything is being shared over there. You are working and not getting salary. Your salary is going to the kibbutz, to the community, and you get everything for free, okay? You get all the services. Your children are being schooled, and you are eating in a dining room, and you are getting health services. Everything is for free, but you don't own anything. You don't have a car. You have a small house and everyone's houses are the same. And the children are growing up together, not in your house, in the children's home. So, and this was, that was the ideal concept of the social socialism, a real equality amongst everyone, right? It doesn't matter if I'm white or black. I eat the same food, I do the same job, and so on. It failed. It failed because we have moved on to capitalism, and the world has moved on, and there were some terrible mistakes done with the children of the kibbutz. And generally, socialism was good for creating the foundations of Israel, but then you have to do a step forward and build on that into a market-led approach. And that was, you know, generally the story. About corruption in Israel. Corruption is around the world. Unfortunately, I cannot say that in Israel we are not corrupted. We are. Unfortunately, our prime minister is now indicted under three cases of corruption. And it's very serious. We take it very, very seriously. I would say that this is at least an evidence that in Israel everybody is equal to the law. And if you took bribe or gave bribe, it doesn't matter if you are a prime minister or a farmer, you are going to go to court on that. But it is a difficult problem. We had to make a lot of changes in this economic transformation. We had to make a lot of changes in order to join the OECD and also to sign a convention, an anti-corruption convention of the OECD, in which we commit to not let go or oversee any corruption. So me, as ambassador, before I went to my position here, I had to sign a contract or a commitment statement that if I see any Israeli committing an offense on which will lead to corruption or giving, it doesn't matter if he is not living in Israel, it doesn't matter if his company is not registered in Israel, I must report. For the last 10 years, since 2010, we see a lot of business people, also politicians, they have to understand that they have to change their ways. It's a problem, I'm not lying. It's a challenge for all of us. And even if sometimes people are saying, well, Africa is so corrupted, right? It just means that in Africa, corruption is done in the open, while in the West, it's under the table. I'm being honest. The last question about what Israel is doing in Africa and how are we leading the developing world into development. Well, we are doing several things. And it's on the governmental level, on the business level, and on the people-to-people level. But one of the things that I would like to stress out here is Mashav. Mashav is the Development and Cooperation Agency of Israel. And in Mashav, from 1958 here in Ghana, we have been trained We have been training more thousands of Ghanaians, okay? We started counting only from the 90s, and from the 90s we have something like 2,500 Ghanaians that were trained by Mashav. Trainings are on agriculture, but water, environment, health, education, a lot of sectors are under these trainings, and we are doing it as part of our government-to-government activity. So one of the things, one of the activities that we have, which is, by the way, also with the private sector, is called agro-studies. We are taking students for agriculture to Israel to study for 11 months in Israel, but it's not only academic studies. It's on the contrary, it's on the job training. So in a week, they have 1 day of studying and 4 days or 5 days of working in the field with an Israeli farmer. And it is 11 months in order for them to see the whole cycle of agriculture. At the end of the day, of course, they are getting paid. They are coming back and they have their own small amount, and they can begin their own agribusiness here in Ghana. This year we have sent the, no, sorry, last year, 2019, we have sent the second batch of students, 70 students. In 2018, the first batch was 50 students, 51, and I really hope that next years we are going to see it coming up and up. By the way, the Philippines are sending 4,000. Okay, so we have a goal. But this is one of the things that we do. And today in the morning, I met an Israeli company who won a tender to establish all around Ghana STEAM centers for schools. STEAMs for science, technology, engineering, math, and art. they won the tender, then they will establish it. And the first two centers that are going to be established will be in Accra and here in Ho. So, yes. So the schools here and children between the ages of 6 and 14 will be able to go. Hopefully that within a year it will be finished. But they will be able to go and do some real research, talk about chemistry, physics, all the applied sciences that you are advocating here. And I am sure, by the way, that they will be happy to cooperate with the university. It will be nice.
Thank you very much. I will take the second round. But before then, we were streaming live to Hohoi so that our campus on the we have a campus at Hohoi School of Public Health, and they are listening to us, and one of them has sent a question, and I think we should listen to the question. So if Bafo can read that question, and then I'll take the registrar, and now the hands are going up. Initially you were shy, now all of you are raising your hands.
Yeah. They would like to know the role of America in your development of your economy. The role America is playing in the development of your economy.
The role the US, America, is playing in the Israeli economy. That is one question. So we'll take note of that.
And then